Hello everyone, in this video, I'll uncover the secret of how SelectKBest works under the hood to find out relevant features for a continuous set of features compared with a continuous target variable, which is the case in linear regression. So let's start by importing the necessary modules. I have a small CSV file called as data.csv, which I load into a data frame called as df. The data frame has a total of 155 rows and 5 columns. Let's also visualize the first 5 rows of my data frame. As you can clearly see, there are 4 features and 1 target column. Both my features and target are continuous in nature. When I say continuous, the values can take up any value in the number line. When I say discrete, the values would be specific points on my number line like 1, 0, 2, 4 or something of that sort. So in our case, my features x1, x2, x3, x4 are continuous, as well as my target variable is continuous in nature. After visualizing my data frame, let's split the data frame into x and y. When I look at the shape of x, I find that there are 155 rows and 4 columns, which was as expected. Similarly, y will have just 1 column and 155 rows. Now that I have visualized x and y individually, let's go on to split the data into training and testing, wherein I train on 70% of my data and test on the remaining 30% of my data. After the split is made, let's visualize the first 5 rows of the X-train data frame. As you can clearly see, these are the first 5 rows of my 4 features x1 to x4. Now, since it's a linear regression problem, I want to find out features which are relevant to my target variable and not include variables which are of least importance. So for filtering out features which are irrelevant to my target column, I use something called as SelectKBest, which accepts 2 input, the first of which is the type of comparison that you want to have. Since in our case, our target column is continuous in nature and our features are also continuous, so the scoring criterion in our case is f_regression. There are different criteria based on if your features are continuous and target is discrete, which is the case of classification. You have a different criterion that you can kind of look up in the scikit-learn's website and learn more from it. But since this is a more simplified version of how SelectKBest works under the hood, I chose a regression problem wherein my features are continuous, my target is continuous. The second parameter is k, which specifies the number of features that I want after my feature selection has concluded. After defining my SelectKBest function, I also use the function called as .fit_transform, which accepts the x-train and y-train values, applies the SelectKBest function to it, and whatever new x-train values are returned is saved into a variable called as x_new. So now let's visualize the first 5 rows of x_new variable. If you look closely, the first column of x_new comes from the x2 column. The second column of x_new comes from the x4 column. So SelectKBest has figured out that x2 and x4 are my relevant columns if I want just 2 columns, and x1 and x3 are not relevant columns for me. So this is how my overall SelectKBest is working from a bird's eye view. But how did SelectKBest understand that x2 is relevant to my target variable y? How did SelectKBest also understand that x4 is relevant to my target variable y? Which is the next part of the video, wherein I go over simple graphs, visualizations and some amount of code to help you understand how SelectKBest works internally. Okay, so let's start by creating a function called as plot_join_plot, which accepts a data frame, the name of the feature column, the name of the target column. It first plots a join plot, which is a function given by the seaborn library. I also annotate the join plot with the Pearson correlation coefficient along with the significance of that correlation coefficient, and I show that plot. So I run this cell to include this in memory. I concatenate my x train and y train into a train_df data frame so that it's easier for referencing the columns. Once I've done that, the first thing that I do is I try to plot a joint plot between my feature x1 and my target variable y. So let's see how the joint plot appears. So as you can clearly see, there is no evident pattern between x1 and y. As x1 increases, y neither decreases or increases. There is a slight decrease or dip that you observe, but that is not significant enough. The Pearson correlation coefficient is -0.091 and the p-value is 0.35. I've created a playlist of videos which explain what p-value is. I'll attach the link of the playlist in the description section of the video. Let's repeat the same plotting exercise with feature x2 and my target variable, and let's see what we observe. As you can see, there is a clear relationship in case of x2 and my target variable y. As x2 increases, my y increases. The Pearson correlation coefficient is 0.51 and the relationship is significant with a small p-value of 2.3 × 10⁻¹. Repeating the exercise for feature x3 and my target variable y, I observe that there is no relationship between x3 and y, as it's evident from the graph, as most of the points are scattered in a very random manner. The Pearson correlation coefficient is 0.02 with a high p-value of 0.84. If your p-value is greater than 0.05, which is the case here, you fail to reject the null hypothesis, which in case of linear regression is that there is no relationship between x and y. So in this case, since I failed to reject the null hypothesis, that simply means there is no relationship between x3 feature and my target variable. I go on to my next combination of feature and target variable, that is x4 and y, and this is what I observe. I get a p-value of 2.6 × 10⁻¹, which is a significant relationship, but the relationship is negative in this case, wherein the correlation coefficient is -0.39. So this is what I observe in case of x4 and y. If you've understood those significance levels so far, I find that x2 and x4 are relevant. X1 and x3 don't share a relationship with my target variable. So this is something that I wanted you to visualize. And now, if this idea is clear, let's see how SelectKBest works under the hood using simple code. The first thing that you'll have to understand is there is a function called Pearson R, which is from the SciPy's package, which accepts two arrays and gives out the correlation coefficient along with the significance value or the p-value. So if I run the cell with R use case, that is the fourth feature, that is x4, along with the y train or the target variable column, I get a value of Pearson correlation coefficient as -0.39 and a p-value of 2.64 × 10⁻¹, which is in line to what I'm observing here. So we are on the right track. Now that you've understood how Pearson R function works, let's now create a list of lists that would capture the feature along with its correlation coefficient with the target variable, along with the significance that it has with respect to the target variable. So this part of the code is essentially doing what I've just mentioned. I've created an empty list. I go over every column in my training data set. I find out the correlation coefficient and the significance of correlation coefficient, and I store it in form of a tuple in core_tuple, and I append that tuple's individual values into the empty list that I created called as out_list. So when I run the cell, I'll have a list of lists. Since I have a list of lists, I convert that into a pandas data frame with the set columns. And this is how my core_df would appear. My first column is my feature column. The second column is the correlation value column. And the third column is the correlation significance column denoted by p-value. So essentially, under the hood, SelectKBest, when you apply the criteria is f_regression, all of these activities would be carried out. And the last activity would be sorting all the features based on the significance value in the ascending order. The concept is very simple. The smaller the p-value, the more is the significance of that relationship. So now when I visualize the overall data frame, this is what I observe. After sorting my data frame based on the p-value, that is from lowest to highest. X2 is the most significant feature with respect to the target variable, having the lowest p-value. Second comes X4, third comes X1, and fourth comes X3. So this is how under the hood SelectKBest figures out the significance level and then sorts it based on the significance level that you have calculated. Once you've done the calculation, it then goes back to find the k value, that is the total number of features that you want, and it chops off the values beyond that k value to not include those features. So in our case, we supplied k equal to 2. So SelectKBest would select x2 and x4. Let's go up and again validate if SelectKBest has selected x2 feature and x4 feature. So I go back up. I have these two values. So this column comes in from the x2 column. This comes in from the x4 column. So this is how SelectKBest works internally for a set of continuous features and a continuous target variable. I hope you found this video informative. If you do have any questions with what we covered in this video, then feel free to ask in the comment section below and I'll do my best to answer those. If you enjoyed these tutorials and would like to support them, then the easiest way is to simply like the video and give it a thumbs up. And also it's a huge help to share these videos with anyone whom you think would find them useful. Please consider clicking the subscribe button to be notified for future videos. And thank you so much for watching the video.